Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see all of you this morning. I decided I would start by asking, I know we do not always see eye to eye on temperature, but can we agree this morning? We're pretty close. Did everybody love it outside this morning? Beautiful morning? I'm hoping nodding heads. Yes, beautiful day today. Glad to have all of you here. Glad for those of you joining us online as well. Welcome to worship. At this time, let's rise, greet those around us, and start with our opening hymn. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Today, as we've gone through our Bible series on the Ten Commandments, we will study the seventh commandment, and so we will start responsibly. The seventh commandment.
You shall not steal.
What does this mean?
We should fear and love God, so that we do not take our neighbor's money or possessions, or get them.
As we prepare then to go to God in confession, we also then especially reflect here in a moment on the seventh commandment. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. moment in silence reflecting on our sinful condition and our need for Jesus' forgiveness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Earlier this month, we introduced a new element to our worship service, which is to include the memory verse that is over at the school, so that really our whole campus is doing this thing of really bringing God's word into our hearts and minds as we try to hold on to it. So, since this is the last Sunday of the month, we're going to say it with up on the screen, and then I'm going to take it away. Well, somebody up here is going to try to, I think, we're going to work. And we're going to try to say it together without any help. And so my encouragement is that we were able to do this, or I hope we're able to. So, he leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. Psalm 25:9. We got to make sure to add that tag in there at the end, right? So you can remember which verse you're remembering. Good, they already did it. Okay, here we go. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. Very nice. I'm just going to walk away. I got so excited I forgot to tag at the end. That was a test, by the way. That's what I was saying. Good job. That was actually very nice. I'm excited for that. And you got me so excited I forgot the tag part to do. Okay. I hope that that turns to be a blessing to you. Right? I think as I look around, I see grins and smiles, maybe because it's been a long time, and maybe you feel like you're in grade school, but it is a tremendous blessing to bring God's word into your heart and mind, and to have it there just waiting for those moments when he'll bring it to the forefront. All right, we continue. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, your mercies are new every morning. And though we deserve only punishment, you receive us as your children and provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant that we may heartily acknowledge your merciful goodness, give thanks for all your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And let's rise as we confess together our common faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
All right, everyone. Am I on? Oh, no, I guess I gotta turn my mic on if I wanna be heard. There we go. Are we on now?
Yes, no, there we go. Sorry up there. All right, I'm giving Katie a break from the announcement since I have some Spring Festival stuff to talk about. We will start, though, with make sure you grab one of these sheets back there so you see all the upcoming things and all the announcements that we have. We have Easter Lilies that we would like, if you would like to sign up for Easter Lilies, please fill out one of the forms in the back, and when you turn in the form, please bring payment with you so we can make sure to get your Easter Lilies ordered. The next item on the list is VBS registration opens this Friday. This Friday, the VBS is gonna be from June 6th to 10th, and all the students who will be in pre-K through fifth grade, are invited to attend that. So if you have a child who is currently in the three-year-old class over at the ECC, but next year will be moving over to the big school, that child is invited to participate in VBS. So next year's pre-K through fifth grade. Let's see, we have the Knights of the Roundtable Gala on Saturday, May 7th. If you would like to participate in that, get some seats, you can buy tickets either through the church office over there or contact Megan Kirk at Classic Bank. The school office. Or Megan Kirk at Classic Bank can handle that. And then we have Holy Week worship services coming up Maundy, Thursday, Good Friday, two services on Good Friday, and then an Easter sunrise service followed by breakfast, and then a service at 9:30 as well. And then moving to the Spring Festival, that is just 2 weeks away. Two Saturdays from today, we will be doing the Spring Festival. You may have seen it on your way in. I put some volunteer sign-up sheets in the back, in the narthex, and then in the entry to the fellowship hall. There are also some items that we need in order to help this go smoothly. Things like utility vehicles to help transport trash and the big bins of Easter eggs. If somebody wouldn't mind bringing a utility vehicle up here, a utility vehicle or two up here, to help with that. That would be fantastic. We need some ice chests, and we need a bench for the Easter Bunny to sit on. So if you've got a nice sort of park bench or a bench in your garden or something like that that you wouldn't mind bringing up here for a couple hours, please sign up. We will, since I put sign-up sheets in both areas, we'll probably double up on a couple things, at least hopefully we'll double up on a couple things. If we don't need whatever you've signed up for, then I'll give you a call and let you know. And the one other thing that I want to announce is the Easter egg stuffing will be happening next Monday, not tomorrow, but next Monday during the Bible study hour at 10:30. And the group that we have coming to Bible study is great, and they'll be able to get a lot of it done, but we have thousands of Easter eggs to stuff. So if you can make it here next Monday at 10:30, we would greatly appreciate your help because we need it. So I think that's about all I have. If y'all have questions for me or anything, please let me know. Give me a call, shoot me an email, talk to me after service, whatever I can do to help answer any of your questions, I will certainly do that. And again, we thank you for everything that you've done for us to help get this going, to help get this started. I think it's going to be a great thing for our community. That's the end of our announcements, except for one last thing. We have a birthday today. Otis Meyer, give me a wave. There we go, right there. We are going to sing happy birthday to Otis.
Birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Continue our service with the collection of the offering. We give back to God a portion of what He has given to us. We here at Emmanuel, again, thank you for all that you do and give so that we can continue our ministry.
Let us pray. Gracious, merciful, loving, generous Father, we give thanks to you for all of our blessings. Lord, we pray that you would accept these offerings as a small portion of thanks of what we can give back to you for all of your generosity. Lord, we pray that you use these offerings to your glory, that they would further your kingdom and the ministries and missions here at Emmanuel as we serve both this congregation and this community. With that, Lord, we pray that you would bless many of the things that we, all of the things that we have coming up. Lord, we pray for our worship services, for the Spring Festival, for Vacation Bible School. We give you thanks for all of those who are willing to serve and for the many hours that our volunteers put in. We give great thanks for that and pray that you would continue to bless us with those who serve. Lord, we lift up other ministries across the nation and our state. We pray for St. Mark Lutheran School in Lake Jackson, for Bethel Lutheran Church in Fort Smith, Arkansas, and for Pathway School in Cedar Park, Texas. Lord, we pray that you continue to bless them and the needs that they have in their communities. We thank you for our PSIA competition held here Friday, and we give thanks for that academic competition and the many gifts and blessings that you've given not only to our students, but for the students across the state, for the volunteers who serve, and for our ability to host people here to share your blessings with them. We rejoice with those celebrating birthdays, with Doris Meyer, Mary Suzo, Otis Meyer, Sylvan Murziansky, Louis Gakey, Sarah Matijic, Marie Albrecht, Ruth Plocky, and Billy Baksha. Lord, we thank you for all of them and pray your continued blessings to each. Lord, we do thank you for the rain that we've received in our area, and we pray for those in other places that do desperately need it. Lord, with the severe storms this week, we pray for those who were impacted directly by that and ask you to be with them, that their needs would be met. Also for those affected by the wildfires, the severe weather, anything that has happened, Lord, we pray that you would continue to support and provide for them. We pray for our confirmation retreat this next Friday and Saturday, Lord, that you would bless their time together, that it would be a blessing to them. Lord, we give you thanks for your other gifts. We thank you for baptism as Boone Cyrus Gakey is brought to the waters of baptism today. We give you thanks for marriage as Jenna Ray Kieschnick and Christopher Orocio were married here yesterday. We celebrate at the birth of Grace and Elaine Gersh, born on March 16th, and pray your blessings upon the entire family. And finally, Lord, we lift up those who we have on our hearts and mind in need of your care for healing. We pray for Adeline Kieschnick, Elton Boyette, Mark McLean, Evelyn Wrench, and Sarah Wadowski. Lord, you know the needs of each. We pray your continued blessing of the doctors, nurses, all the health professionals who care for them, that they would bring your help and healing to each of those and any others that we have in our hearts and minds. Lord, we pray for these things and any of the things we worry about in Jesus' name as we pray together now the prayer that he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our first reading this morning today is from Genesis 27, beginning with the 30th verse. As soon as Isaac had finished blessing Jacob, when Jacob had scarcely gone out from the presence of Isaac his father, Esau his brother came in from his hunting. He also prepared delicious food and brought it to his father. And he said to his father, "Let my father arise and eat of his son's game, that you may bless me." His father Isaac said to him, "Who are you?" He answered, "I am your firstborn, Esau." Then Isaac trembled very violently and said, "Who was it then that hunted game and brought it to me, and I ate it all before you came, and I have blessed him? Yes, and he shall be blessed." As soon as Esau heard the words of his father, he cried out with an exceedingly great and bitter cry and said to his father, "Bless me, even me also, O my father." But he said, "Your brother came deceitfully, and he has taken away your blessing." Esau said, "Is he not rightly named Jacob? For he has cheated me these two times. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he has taken away my blessing." Then he said, "Have you not reserved a blessing for me?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is a psalm reading today from Psalm 50. Hear, O my people, and I will speak. O Israel, I will testify against you. I am God, your God. Not for your sacrifices do I rebuke you. Your burnt offerings are continually before me. I will not accept a bull from your house or goats from your folds. For every beast of the forest is mine, the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know all the birds of the hills, and all that moves in the field is mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world and its fullness are mine. Do I eat the flesh of bulls and drink the blood of goats? Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving, and perform your vows to the Most High, and call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise as you're able for this morning's gospel reading. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 19th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through, and there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich, and he was seeking to see who Jesus was. But on account of the crowd, he could not because he was of small stature. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was about to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. So he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all grumbled, he has gone in to be the guest of a man who was a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold. And Jesus said to him, today, salvation has come to this house, since he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
If any kids would like to come join me for a children's message, come on up. Good morning, everyone. How are you guys? Good. Today we are looking at the 7th commandment. So for the last few weeks, we've been looking at commandments from the 10 commandments and looking at how the 10 commandments really help us to love our neighbor, to love the people around us, to show them that we care about them. Do you guys know, or did you hear earlier in the service, what the 7th commandment is? Anybody remember? You remember, David? You shall not steal. Good. The 7th commandment is you shall not steal. Do you guys know what it means to steal when we talk about stealing? Yeah. Take away someone's toys might be the biggest way that you guys are familiar with it. Stealing is taking away something that's not yours to have. Now, I know we have some baseball players in here, so we're not going to talk about stealing bases, because that's okay. That's allowed. But stealing in life is taking away something that's not yours to have. And we heard 2 readings today about people who stole. We heard about Zacchaeus. Do you guys know about Zacchaeus? The short little man who was a tax collector? He had to climb up in a tree so that he could see Jesus walk past through the crowd. And then Jesus went to Zacchaeus' house, and the people were kind of angry with Jesus. They said, why are you going to hang out with Zacchaeus, the tax collector? Because we don't like tax collectors. Do you know why they didn't like tax collectors? Yeah, David. They take some of the tax for themselves. So what they do is they know how much tax is supposed to get paid to the Romans. And then, so they charge the people that, but then they charge them a little bit more so that they can have some extra to put in their own pocket. So the tax collectors were stealing money from the people in their towns. They're stealing money from their brothers and sisters and their community members. Okay? Then we heard a story about two brothers, Jacob and Esau. And we got to hear just the very end of their story when Esau discovers that Jacob has stolen something from him. But this time it wasn't a thing. It wasn't money or a toy or an animal or anything like that. It was a blessing. It was words spoken from their father, a gift to his oldest son, that Jacob tricked Isaac into giving to him instead of Esau. And he stole that blessing, and it wasn't his to have. As we look at the Bible, and this is where the third reading that we heard comes in, is anything that we have, is it ours originally? Who might it have belonged to before it became ours? Okay, nature. Who made nature? God did. So everything that exists, everything that's been given to people, belonged to God first. He created it. He made that. And then he gave it out to his people for them to take care of and for them to use. And so he has given us the things that are supposed to be ours to take care of and to use. And he has given other people the things that are supposed to be theirs to take care of and to use. And he tells us, don't steal from other people. Don't take what's not yours to have. Don't take what I didn't give you. And so as we look at this commandment, we remember not to take things that don't belong to us, but also we help people to keep what God has given to them. So what might that look like? We talked about stealing toys earlier. If we're not steal toys, we understand that one, right? Don't take a toy that doesn't belong to you. How might you help a friend or a brother or sister keep a toy that belongs to them? Yeah, David. Okay, we can share. Yeah, we can share with them. What if you see it just left laying somewhere? What could you do? Okay, you could ask to borrow it, sure. If you just see it laying somewhere, though, and I said, ooh, I know that this is Case's toy, should I take it home with me? Is it my toy? No. What should I do with it? Yeah, find Case, right? Give it to Case. Just like at school, there are sweatshirts and jackets and water bottles all over the gym, right? And it's really helpful when you guys, as kids, as friends, can look at something and say, I'm pretty sure that that's Cash's jacket. And you give that jacket back to Cash. I'm pretty sure that belongs to David. I'm pretty sure that belongs to Eli. And you give them back what's theirs instead of saying, finders keepers, it's mine now. Right? Because God has given us all the things that we need for our lives. He gives it to us as a gift to take care of and to use in our own lives. And so we want to make sure that as much as we have our things, we help our neighbors, our friends, keep their things that belong to them. And in that way, it sounds silly maybe, but in that way we show them that we love them. We show them that we love them just by helping them keep what belongs to them. All right? Let's fold our hands. I don't know, these commandments are hard. There's a reason we don't do confirmation till a little bit later. Fold our hands and repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for the things you've given to me and my family. Help me to help others keep their things as you have given those to them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, you guys. You can head back to your seats.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You shall not steal. Tax season is here. Connect the dots however you will. I'm not here to preach today and tell you that taxation is theft, because it's not. Jesus said, render unto Caesar what is Caesar. So pay your taxes. I mean, after all, if we didn't have taxes, a lot of the basic things that we use, that we have around us all the time would not be here. I mean, policemen, roads, schools, taxes pay for a lot of these things that we use all the time. However, our government, I think we can all agree, at times misuses the tax money. And when our tax money is misused, that is something that we can point to and say, you shall not steal. And it's not just government, right? We have these big, huge corporations, these global corporations based here in America. As I was doing some research this week, I was just looking at some of their labor practices, and you'd be surprised to learn that, or maybe you wouldn't be surprised, I don't know, to learn that a lot of the biggest corporations use very, very cheap labor from other countries, sometimes even bordering on slave labor or child labor, to produce their things. And then when they get over here, you know, we walk through the department stores and they're $200 shoes sitting on the rack, $100 shirts. I actually watched a documentary the other day where a guy was wearing a $10,000 shirt. A $10,000 shirt. Things that most people can't afford. You shall not steal. So the government does it, big corporations do it, but what about right here in our local areas, you know? We should fear and love God so that we do not take our neighbor's money or possessions or get them in any dishonest way. That's something that we need to keep in mind every time we deal with anybody, anytime we're buying, selling, doing really anything. I mean, there's this show that I like to watch on Netflix called Swap Shop. It's kind of similar to American Pickers, if you're familiar with that show. And the whole premise is based on people who go out and try and buy something cheap and then come back and sell it for more expensive. They try to buy something for less than it's worth and then sell it for more than it's worth. And we have this big antique show going on down the road, right? The Round Top Antique Festival. And that's exactly what goes on there. People going there to buy something for less than it's worth. People there selling things for more than it's actually worth. Is that dishonest? Is that breaking the seventh commandment? I mean, how much profit is too much profit? Right? If a dresser is marked at $500, but they'll sell it for $300, why not just mark it at $300? Why not just sell it? Why not just buy it for $300? Or if it's marked for $500, why not just buy it for $500? You can come back at me with things like, well, you know, something is worth what someone will pay for it. If someone will buy it for $500, I'll sell it to them for $500. Right? Or yeah, but negotiating is part of the fun. It's part of the experience. Everyone does it. Everyone does it. It's what everyone does. But if everyone does it, does that make it okay? And one more example that really hit home for me, because, you know, all of these things that I've talked about are things that we can point to and say, you shall not steal, you shall not steal, you shall not steal. But the commandments are really meant to point to us, for us to point to ourselves, not to point to others and point out their faults. The seventh commandment is given to us by God so that we know our own faults. So something that hits home for me often, I will admit, hits home for me very often, and probably will for you too, is that a lot of us work for somebody else. Somebody else is paying us to do a job. Are they paying us to look at Facebook? Are they paying us to text our spouse about what we're going to have for dinner this evening? Are we being paid to talk to our coworkers about our weekend, last weekend, or our upcoming weekend? Everyone breaks the seventh commandment. Everybody does it. We do what everyone else is doing. You shall not steal. Luther, when he was writing about the seventh commandment, talked about all these little things that people do to try and get out of work. How they try and not do their job to the fullest ability. How they don't do everything that they're supposed to do. And when you read what he wrote, you realize that breaking into somebody's house and stealing their TV is just the tip of the iceberg when it comes to breaking the seventh commandment. Martin Luther wrote in his large catechism, "If we were to hang every thief on the gallows, especially those who do not admit it, the world would soon be empty and there would be a shortage of both hangmen and gallows." When it comes to the seventh commandment, everybody breaks it. Everybody does it. We are all thieves. In our gospel reading for today, Luke writes at the time when Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, on his way to the cross, and he encountered another thief, Zacchaeus, the chief tax collector. Zacchaeus, a wee little man was he. So he climbed up into the sycamore tree to get a peek at Jesus as he was walking by. Up to that point in Zacchaeus' life, he was doing what everybody else was doing. Taking his neighbor's money and possessions, getting them in a dishonest way. You see, the tax collectors, as Katie pointed out in her children's sermon, stealing my thunder a little bit, thanks, Katie, but the tax collectors at that time would steal from the people around them, the people that they saw in their everyday lives. They would add to the taxes that the people owed and keep that addition in their own pocket. They lined their own pocket with the people's money. And why not do it? Everybody was doing it. Why not line their own pockets? And Luke makes it a point to say that Zacchaeus was rich. He was the chief tax collector. He had been doing this for a long, long time. He was good at it. And the crowd knew that. The crowd knows it, and they call Zacchaeus a sinner. He's the chief tax collector. You might call him the chief of sinners. You might call him the chief thief. And yet this is the man that Jesus calls out to. Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. That one little sentence has a profound impact on this wee little man. Jesus calls out to the chief tax collector, the chief of sinners. He dines with the chief thief, for the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. And that's what Zacchaeus is. He's lost. But so is everyone else in the crowd. But they refuse to acknowledge it. They are sons of Abraham, children of the promise. They are the ones to whom God has promised all things, the ones to whom God gives all good things. But they are thieves too. In Psalm 50, our psalm reading for today, in Psalm 50, God tells us, "For every beast of the forest is mine, the cattle on a thousand hills. I know all the birds of the hills, and all that moves in the field is mine." It all belongs to God, and He gives it to them. He gives it to them. Now they think that they're entitled to it. Not only are they taking their neighbor's possessions and money, they're taking the things that belong to God. And the proper response to God's provision, to God's good gifts, is thanksgiving. The proper response is loving God and loving neighbor. But they don't do that. They are sons of Abraham. We have Abraham's blood flowing in our veins. We're not sinners. We are not thieves. We are sons of Abraham. The kingdom of God belongs to us. And yet, they don't even recognize the kingdom of God as He walks past them in their own streets and calls up to the chief of sinners. "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." We should fear and love God so that we help our neighbor to improve and protect his possessions and income. Whereas Zacchaeus, for his entire life, for his entire career, has been doing what everyone else had been doing, he now does something that no one else is doing. Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, "Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold." Repentance. Doing something no one else is doing. The call of the Lord Jesus, His coming to this chief thief, dining with him, loving him, shows Zacchaeus how to love God and how to love his neighbor as himself. And then Jesus said, "Today salvation has come to this house, since he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." They have the blood of Abraham. Zacchaeus has the same faith as Abraham. They think they aren't sinners. They think they aren't thieves. Zacchaeus knows he's a sinner. Zacchaeus knows he's a thief. They think the kingdom of God belongs to them. Zacchaeus knows the kingdom of God belongs to him. Jesus called him. Jesus came to seek and save the lost. He does the same thing today. He comes to seek and save the lost. He calls out to sinners. He dines with thieves. You have the same faith that Abraham had, the same faith that Zacchaeus had, faith in the promise of God found only in Christ Jesus. On the cross, Jesus' body and blood were given and shed for you. You too are sons and daughters of Abraham. And in Holy Communion, Jesus dines with you. He dines with sinners. He dines with thieves. When you stop and think about the seventh commandment, the implications that it has for today's society, our economy, our everyday dealings with each of our neighbors, you realize just how sinful we all are, how sinful and broken the world is. This might be the most far-reaching of the commandments when you stop and really dig into it. And I'm not going to pretend to stand here and have all the answers, how to fix everything that's wrong. I don't. No one does. No one can. So how do we love God and love our neighbor when everything is so backwards and so broken, so messed up? Be like Zacchaeus. Do something no one else is doing. You know, Matthew Harrison, who is the president of the LCMS, before he was elected president, he was the director of Lutheran World Relief. So he traveled to a lot of third world countries. And he talks about the practice that people have of going to third world countries and looking for deals in the marketplace. What people do is they go to the marketplace and they go to the merchant and try and talk the merchant down as low as the merchant can go until they can buy something for a great deal. They think they've got a great score. But Harrison, on the other hand, talks about what he does when he goes to the marketplaces in these third world countries. He asks, how much, and then he gives more. How much, and then he gives more. Why? Number one, because he can afford it. He can do that. Number two, because these people selling in these marketplaces depend on these sales to survive, to put food on the tables for their families. And three, because it's still a really good deal. How do you apply that today? How do you apply that to Round Top? Can you afford the $500 dresser without the negotiating? Then maybe just buy it. Or if you still want to negotiate, maybe don't go all the way low. Maybe just give it to them, or give them a decent price. Don't go as low as you can go. You still have the fun of negotiating, but maybe you don't get the rock bottom price. You give a little something to your neighbor. Or maybe when you're at work, you just work. You don't have to make this big, great, grand gesture that Zacchaeus did. Zacchaeus was the chief tax collector. He was rich. Now, if you can make the grand gesture, I'm not going to stop you. But all of us can do something small. Small changes that show our love of God and our love for our neighbor. Do something no one else is doing. You shall not steal. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so that we do not take our neighbor's money or possessions or get them in any dishonest way, but help him improve and protect his possessions and income. In Jesus' name, amen. In the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep and guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Please rise and receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.